So these are the grade 11 pre-calculus notes. Towards the end of the course there. You can always slow them down with Control Shift S, put them back to normal, Control Shift, and I'll run them pretty much at 4 to 8 times the speed. You can always pause them or rewind them. Okay, so let's get on with it. It's mostly algebra and a little bit of trigonometry. So we had a bit of a warm-up here back on the 4th of February. Three little questions. We've been doing this all along, especially back in grade 10. Question 1 there. You try to factor it, but at least you can take out a 4. And you can't really do anything with x squared plus 2x plus 4. It's pretty much done. The second one is a perfect square trinomial. It's x plus 3 all squared. What multiplies to give 9 and adds to make 6. There you go. And you might identify number 3 as being the difference of squares. So, provided that the first term is a perfect square and the second term is a different perfect square, turns out that something squared minus something squared is just the something plus the other something times the something minus the other something. Yeah, difference of squares, check it out. And then we're on to, just to remind you how to find a vertex in a domain, stuff like that. It's back in unit A. It's sort of handy to use in unit C here when you're doing quadratic equations, so you can sort of get a picture in your head of what's going on. We'll do lots of this in grade 12. Picturing curves in your head. Anyway, when you do it with the calculator, it tells you the answer is negative 1.5 and negative 21.75 for the vertex. Obviously, that's wrong. It shouldn't be a negative 1.5. So I just wrote it down wrong. It's 1.5, positive 1.5. In any event, we'll correct that shortly. The domain is always for these types of functions, from negative infinity to positive infinity. To find the vertex, of course, you took the negative of the b divided by 2 times the a, which worked out to be their 3/2, not negative 3/2. And then you took that 3/2 and you plug it back into the equation to find the associated y, and you'll find out that the y is negative 21 3/4, pretty much what the computer said. There, and I corrected the equation there. So that was a warm-up for quadratic functions, how to graph them and what they looked like. And here's another warm-up of, this will be a warm-up of completing the square. The way I teach completing the square is you don't like to have a coefficient on the x squared. You want it to be 1. So you got to divide everything by that leading coefficient. You'll end up sneaking it back later. And then you calculate the magic number. And the magic number is the b inside the brackets there divided by 2 all squared. So you add 9/4, take away 9/4. That magically becomes x minus 3/2 all squared. A little bit of smoke and mirrors with the fractions there. Well, you know how it works. Just watch this. It's kind of cool. It all works out in the wash. And all we're doing is converting it into the standard form that we can see the intercept and the vertex, correction, the vertex. So pretty soon we'll be using the completing the square to solve things and find the zeros, not just the vertex. Well, here we go. We're going to find the x-intercepts, also called the zeros. And we're going to do it on a computer. So the last equation we just had there, this equation here. So that's the last equation we had. What are the zeros? Well, when you do it on a graphing calculator, if you remember how to do that stuff, you end up with those zeros up there. Or you can use that quadratic formula. The negative of the b plus and minus the square root of the b squared minus 4 times the a times the c all divided by 2 times the a. And if you carefully plug everything in, and be very careful with the subtracting of negatives, you will discover that you end up with 9 plus or minus the square root of 261, all divided by 6. Well, if you actually take a calculator to show you what that means in Earthling numbers, look how it works out to be exactly the same thing as what the graph on the electronic calculator told you. And in theory, if you took that 9 plus or minus the square root of 261 divided by 6 and plugged it back into the original equation, you would end up with the answer. It would all work out to be 0. And I think we did that in class. So the general rule is to always equate your quadratics to 0 to solve. All right? Especially for, well, it's essential, rather, for factoring and the quadratic formula. All right, so you always equate to 0. So in this case here, you want to move that 2 on the right-hand side over to the left-hand side. And now that's how you calculate your A's and your B's and your C's to squeeze into the quadratic formula. If you don't make it equal to 0, then the A, B, C's don't make any sense. Just check out on the right there. I'm just reminding people that technically you should put negative 1 in brackets, all squared, for example, if that's the B, because negative 1 squared is not the same as negative 1 squared. All right, so here was an example. If we stood Monica on the ledge of the window, we're 30 meters up, and we decide to give her a little boost, 5 meters upwards per second, how long before she hits the ground? Well, the actual equation for height on the Earth of anything flying through the air is 4.9 times t squared plus 5 times t plus the height you start at, so 30 meters, say. And the 5t just means we gave her a boost upwards. When you plug in those numbers, you end up with, in the quadratic formula, you end up with 4.6 seconds for her to impact the ground. Okay, unless I messed that up. Did I put in 4.2? Whatever. It ends up being about 4 and a bit seconds. And I think I got a software stall here. Oh, there she goes. So that's why we do the quadratic formula, to find out when things are zero. Because normally when you hit the ground, it becomes kind of important. And we didn't calculate the negative time before she jumped, because we're only interested in the positive time after she jumped. Here's another equation. Don't forget to equate it all to 0. There we go. Equate it to 0. A is 2. B is negative 9. C is 2. Make sure you put things in the standard order, right? The x squareds, and then the x term, and then the constant term. And another reminder on the right there that negative 2 squared is not the same as negative 2 squared. Just be careful with that. Most people write it the wrong way but still calculate it correctly. Well, now we're getting into a reminder on how to reduce radicals. We've done this the week before. The square root of 72, the proper way to say it is 6 times the square root of 2. And the way I got at that was I factored out a 36, because a 36, the square of a 36 is 6. Correction, the square root of a 36 is 6. Same thing with 24. If you did the square root of 24, technically, you should reduce it and say something a little more concise. You could say the square root of 24 is the square root of 4 times the square root of 6, but you know the square root of 4 is 2. So 2 root 6 is the proper way to write the square root of 24. It's like reducing fractions. You're trying to factor out 4 and 9 and 16 and 25 and 36. Okay, so here's the Monday. Well, this is the Tuesday. B squared minus 4ac, that was your formula. Now, the b squared minus 4ac, the part under the radical sign, or the sir, as they call it in England, so under in the radicand there, under the radical, that tells you something important. All right? If it's exactly zero, well, look, you're going to end up with a negative B plus or minus nothing over 2A. You're going to get one answer, one rational root. It'll be a fraction. That's why we call it rational. It'll look something as a curve that'll just kiss the x-axis. If it's less than zero, it'll be negative. And you can't take the square root of a negative number. If it's more than zero and it's a perfect square, such as 1, 4, 9, 16, 25, 36, 49, 81, all those, then you're going to end up with two rational roots. Rational means fractions. In other words, you won't have any ugly radicals in it. And if it's something that's not a perfect square, like 23 or 19 or 11 or 10, then you're going to end up with something with a plus and minus, some sort of a square root in it. There's nothing wrong with square roots. I mean, we're going to do lots and lots of work with square. There's actually more square roots than there are counting numbers. So, let's see. Oh, let's try again. This is in our notes. X squared minus X minus 12 equals 0. So paragraph 31 in our notes. Well, that's an A of 1, a B of negative 1, and a C of negative 12. You always got to equate it to 0, otherwise the ABCs don't make sense. So your discriminant is B squared minus 4AC. That tells you something special. Okay. It works out to be 49, which tells you you're going to have two rational roots. Check it out on your cheat sheet. You're always allowed to use your reference notes, your cheat sheet. 49 is just 7 squared. You know it's going to work out to a sweet answer. Chances are you can factor it, too. That's the beauty of it. Well, look, you can factor it. Let's try another one here. Notice how I've already conveniently equated it to 0. B squared minus 4 times the A times the C. Be very careful with that 4 subtract a negative 48. Taking away a negative is adding. Notice that's 52. So since the square root of 52 is not a perfect square like 49 or 36 or 64, you know you're going to end up with 2 irrational. Irrational means something with square roots in it, because no square root can be written as a fraction. So you won't have any ratios or fractions. Let's try B. B ends up being the determinant there is B squared minus 4AC. So it's 2 squared minus 4 bunches of negative 1 times negative 18. Looks like a 4 minus a 72. Yep. So you end up with a negative 68. Now, you can't do the square root of a negative number. So you really have no real answer. You get some of those imaginary answers, but don't go building a bridge with imaginary answers. And you can even do it with C there, x squared minus 4. Notice there is no B term. So the quadratic formula is going to be kind of easy. And when you plug in the discriminant, the b squared minus 4 times the a times the z, look how nicely that works out. It ends up that it's, in this case, a negative negative 16, so it's a positive 16. So you know you have two rational roots, since 16 is a perfect square. It's 4 fours. Let's try some more discriminant. And don't forget, you can use your chart and your reference notes. It's all there. You always equate to 0, otherwise the